going to see that we are seeing. Variance, in the last session, we have talked about the variances, how exactly the variance is calculated. Okay, that is shown over here. And that's called the variance of data is 3.91. And the variance is difficult to understand and interpret, particularly how strange its units are. See, remember, when the data set, though the data set is different, their variance can also be same. Okay, for example, if the observation in our data set are measured in pounds, then the variance will be measured in square pounds. Remember, it's measuring the squares of it. Why? Because actually we are measuring the deviation spread, and standard deviation is the square root of variance here. Fine. So we can say that the observations are on average 3.91 square pounds far from the mean 3.5. Like that can be considered as the variance. So fortunately, the standard deviation will come to fix this problem. It's called square pounds. That's why the square root of it will be another measure of dispersion here, and that is what we call as the standard deviation. Now see, what do you mean by standard deviation? Most of the time, this terminology is used to measure the spread of the data in the set of data set. So standard deviation measures the amount of variation or dispersion in the set of numeric values, just like variance we have. Standard deviation is also used for the same purpose. But standard deviation is the square root of variance. That is what we have, sigma square is the variance, and deviation, standard deviation denoted by the sigma. So if you want to calculate the standard deviation, then all we just have to do is to take square root of the variance like this. So standard deviation is equal to square root of variance. So it's like, check it out, 1 by n into the summation of all element from I is equal to 1 to n for xi minus x dash. So x dash is the, what we say, mu value, which is the mean of all. Here we are subtracting and then finding square of it, then combining all together, finding average, and then we are finding the square root of it. That is called as the standard deviation. Okay, so standard deviation is the square root of variance. Now we'll see the things practically also, how this deviation is calculated, what are the functions present there, and in all summary can also be seen. Again, we need to distinguish between population standard deviation, which is the square root of population variance, okay, and the sample standard deviation, which is the square root of sample variance. Remember that. So same denotions are used over here. So you can see we denote the sample standard deviation as S is equal to square root of S2. So sample variance, we got S2, and population variance is sigma 2, sigma square or S square, like that we are having over here. Now the methods are there, the technique which are used, just you can see the formula. So looking at the formula, the deviations are calculated. Remember, standard deviation is the best method by which you can check the variability inside the data. How far the element are present from the center or mean of all the element, that is specified by deviation, standard deviations also. So there are 6 steps that are used to find the standard deviation. List each score and find their mean. Okay, everyone, so whatever data element are there, you have to find their mean. Then subtract the mean from each score to get the deviation from the mean. That's what we have seen, x minus mu. So mu is calculated as a mean, x minus xi minus mean for every of them. Then square each of these deviations. So you subtract from every of the deviations, okay, every of the mean, every element from the mean, okay, then add all the squared deviations. So we have squared it, and then we all add all the deviation, then divide the sum of square deviation by n minus 1. Divide the sum of square deviations by n minus 1, and then find the square root of number you found. So first 5 steps are for variance, and last step, which is given over here, is the standard deviation, to find the deviation of it. Now what interpretation we can say about the standard deviation here? See, low values of standard deviation tells us that individual values are closer to mean. Individual values are closer to the mean. When they are very close to mean, the standard deviation value is very low. High values, on the other hand, tells us that individual observations are far away from the mean of the data. They are far away from the mean of the data. Values that are within one standard deviation of the mean can be thought of as fairly typical, whereas the value where 3 or more standard deviations away from the mean can be considered much more atypical. And they are known as outliers. Outliers means the element which are far away from the mean, or far away from the crowd actually, they are called as the outliers, which is we can identify with the help of the considered deviations, standard deviations over here. So how values or deviations are there, based on that we can find the spread of the data within the data set, individual values. So high or low value of deviation will tell us that. Now see, this is what we can check it, the standard deviation present over here. If you are trying to estimate the standard deviation of the population using the sample of data, then will be served using n minus 1 degrees of freedom. Here is a mathematical expression we typically use to estimate the population variance. So that's what the population variance we can have, and the square root of it's like we can make in this particular way, it's a standard deviation. Let's see. So there are many ways present by which we can find the standard deviation or the standard deviation. Almost every package like SciPy, NumPy, statistics, or in pandas also, the standard deviation is possible. Just a minute, I'll show you how to do or how to find the standard deviation of the data. The code that we have seen in the last session. Okay, so wait a minute, that I will show you, and then we'll talk about the calculation of standard deviations by using the internal library. And we will also see that if the values are changing, okay, if the values are changing, then how it will affect the deviation present inside it. Okay, deviation present, or if you are directly calculating the population variance and then using that you can calculate the standard deviation, that is also possible here in the programming there. Let's see that. Wait a minute. Okay. Okay, so few topics that we have seen. Now see, a simple function I have created here. You can see the statements which I mentioned. Using that statement, this a simple function I have created, like you find the length of the data, then sum divided by mean of the data, and then here we got the deviations of it. Whatever deviations you got from mean into square of it for every element and sum of deviation divided by n, we got the variance. So variance present in this data. Okay, it's like 5.76. Okay, 5.76. That's what we have seen. And now if you use this data and I want to calculate the same thing by using the function, internal function, population variance there. So I'm using it. You just check it out. What I've done, the data which is present over here, it's like this. Check this. It's completely different units, different magnitude is present there. But the dispersion, the spread within them is same. If you just check it out, for example, if I write, this is what we need to understand before actually working in machine learning. See what I'll do. Let's calculate the variance of this data. Okay, so it's st dot p variance of okay, this data. Now you can observe that the variance of this data and variance of this data is same, though their magnitudes are different. Remember, so variance is not changing. Variance is same. Variability is same. So statistical relations, when they are, they require the data that they don't want to change relation, they want to have a different same variance but different values. So that time these methods are used. You can see variance of all this data, the variability present inside it is same, 5.76, and if you check this one, it's also same, 5.76 as it is. Okay, remember, so whatever magnitudes are there, it doesn't matter how much variance we have. And same thing is applicable to the standard deviation also. Remember, same thing is applicable to standard deviation also. So let's talk about the deviations now. Yes, now here, so I have created one more function. So here is a variance function. This is what we have seen above. I've just written in small functionality here, same. And using this idea of variance, I have calculated standard deviation by the internal by a user defined function here. So I'm creating a one function here. You can see I have defined one function in Python, stdev, standard deviation of data that you pass. So what I've done, I'll calculate the variance of it first by using the above function, and then math.sqrt. so sqrt is a function which is present in the math package of Python, which is used to find the square root of the data. So whatever variance I got, I'm finding square root of it, and I'm storing in std underscore dev variable here, and then I'm printing it. So when I'm calling this function of stdev on a set of data, it will calculate the variance first and then calculate the standard deviation of it. Okay, fine. Now see, I'm applying this standard deviation function here. Okay, st.stdev. So you can check it out. So I just changed a bit, small values I have changed over here. Okay, so similar kind of, okay, magnitudes are different, but if you observe the deviation, okay, the deviation present in between these two are almost same. Almost they are same. So most of the time, many machine learning algorithms are basically, they are very sensitive to the magnitude. Sensitive to the magnitude means magnitude changes their output, but relation doesn't. So what we have to do is we are keeping the same deviation in the data, and it is in a similar deviation you apply the data as input. It's part of practice that we will see when we require to handle and perform this normalization concept. That time this deviation concept is used for multiple number of times there. So these are the methods that we can apply to use the standard deviation. Now see, if different variability is present in the data set, I'll show you one more data set. For example, I'm reading a data set from a CSV file, and I want to check what variabilities are present, variance and the standard deviations are present in it, that we can see. I'll just show you one way. See, for example, I'm having a data set present over here. Okay, it's like, sorry, just a minute, it's in home. See, so a simple data set I have here. So we need to import pandas. Okay, so I imported a data set, and just can check there are some data set data present inside it. It contains user ID, gender, age, salary, and purchased or not, something like is mentioned there. Now I want to find the deviations present in this particular data, or numerical data only. So there is a function in pandas also called as std, which we can apply here, like df dot std. Find a standard deviation. Now you can observe that the deviation present in it, user IDs contain deviation of 71,000. See, huge variance, variability, dispersion of data is present. Age is 10, very less in age column. For estimated salary, it is 34,000 deviations is there. And for purchase, it is 0.47 deviation is present, standard deviation is present. You can see the spread of the data, dispersion of the data within it's very different, too much different there. Okay, when the spread is different, obviously impact of that particular data in the predictive modeling is different, because the relation is completely different. Now you can observe this one also. When the, though the magnitudes are different, their relation is same. Relation within they are same. That's why they are almost similar kind of deviation we got. Here is not the case there. So statistics basically works on relation, not on magnitude. Remember, so to keep magnitude different and relation same, we'll be making use of some method. But to identify that one, we need to use this methods of standard deviation to find how much deviation from the mean is present inside the data set. So these methods are used to perform the find the standard deviations, and many are there in sci-fi also. See, if you are going to check, wait a minute. Okay, if I import sci-fi package, scientific Python, inside that stats package is there. Okay, and in this, if I want to use some sci-fi dot stats dot stats. Okay, so many are there. I think it's not present here. Again, one more package is there. Inside, it's possible to have the standard deviation. I think in NumPy is present. In NumPy also, yes, deviation can be calculated, but it works basically on the array functions. Practically speaking, when you're using machine learning concept, we are using the data frames. So just like DF, which we can see, a DF on data frame and series kind of objects. So data frame, when number of elements are more, series is more, single element, we can calculate it there. For example, I just want to calculate the standard deviation of only estimated salary, or sorry, only age. So let's go for that. DF of age dot std. So only for that column, I can calculate the standard deviation. So I can create the function from scratch by this particular method that we can see here, or we can use the inbuilt libraries also. So inbuilt library, okay, it's okay to use, but we need to understand how exactly it is calculated, which formula, which method is used to calculate it. That's what we need to understand and remember. Fine. So let's continue with another method of dispersion over here. Okay, so let's go for that. make sure either deviation or variance, any of one of these method can be used to find a dispersion, okay, because they are connected together. Now, the third method is called as mean deviation. So mean deviation is defined as a statistical measure which is used to calculate the average deviation from the mean of the given data set. Average deviations, we are not directly using the values square and square roots over here, so direct comparison is present. So mean deviation of the data values can be easily calculated using the below procedure, like find the mean value for a given data set, fine, then subtract mean value from each of the data value and ignore the minus symbol. It means that we are going to calculate the absolute value from it. Absolute values, with this value should not be negative, and find the mean of those values obtained in the step number two. Okay, this is called as the mean deviation that we can calculate. You can see how mean deviation is there. Mean deviation doesn't contain the concept of square and square root. Here we apply the concept of absolute values. So values which are negative, that will be become, that will become positive. I want only the difference, positive or negative doesn't matter. Fine, that is mean deviation we call. Now see the formula which is used to calculate the mean deviation. See, mean deviation given data set is given by summation of all the element, that is from xi to mu, okay, subtract all the deviations, all the differences, and divide by total number of elements. So summation is the addition of all the values. X is individual value in the data set. I just want to start n, I is equal to 0 to n minus 1. I is equal to 0 to n minus 1. For all the values, we have to perform the operation of subtracting xi minus mu. So mu is the value of mean, okay, and when you had addition of all the differences divided by n, fine, that is what we are having the concept here. And what absolute means, this is what we call absolute values. We are doing finding only positive values there, negative values are deleted. Let's take an example how the mean deviation is actually calculated. So previous examples, and just like we calculate manually also, I'll show you how to calculate that programmatically also. Now determine the mean deviation of the data values for 5, 3, 7, 8, 4, 9. Okay, so I have a set of values here, 5, 3, 7, 8, 4, 9. We know that the procedure to calculate the mean deviation, which is mentioned, is very easy to do. First of all, we have to calculate the mean of all the values. Mean, that is mu, is equal to addition of all divided by 6. So if you add all these values together, we'll get 36 here. So 36 divided by 6, correct, we'll get the round figure number, that is 6 is a mean of these values present over here. And then after, now subtract the mean from each of the values and ignore the minus. That is, we exactly take only absolute values there, not the negative value. Negative value will be discarded there. So see all of them. First we got differences 1, then 3, then 1, then 2, then 2, and finally 3. Okay, so all the data set we got. Okay, so the mean value from obtained data set, therefore the deviations, we added all together. So 2 is the mean absolute deviation from all. Okay, it means that, see, interpretation is like, okay, all of these values are at equal distance. They're having average distance from the mean is 2. Average distance is 2. Remember, from the mean, on average, they're at this location. Whatever unit that they follow, for example, meter, so 2 meter average distance. All units are in meter, so this will be 2 meters. Inches, 2 inches. Okay, liters, 2 liters, like that. Oh, so unit will be same for this case also. So the mean deviation actually very easily calculated, rather than the other values that we are seeing for variance and the standard deviations present over here. Okay, we'll see this practically also. We'll go for the another set of element, that is called as range. Okay, now let's talk about the range. So range is the difference between the maximum value and the minimum value in the data set, that is called as the range. Simple. Range is the difference between maximum value and minimum value present in the data set. So range is equal to maximum minus minimum. So simply, so let's see both of them also, how they are actually calculated. And if you compare all of these dispersions together, all of these dispersions also we can combine together, and based on that we can identify how which method is better for it. So practically speaking, The method of standard deviation is very commonly used to find the dispersion present in the data set there. So let's check it out. See, okay, first of all, we'll calculate the mean absolute deviation for the data set present over here. Okay, just a minute. See, for example, okay, so data set which is present above that I'm taking over here in x variable, fine. So what we call mean absolute deviation. So we have to calculate the mean first. Let's say m is equal to x, sum of x, sorry, divided by ln of x. Okay, so that's the value we got. Mean is 5.2, correct? The mean is 5.2. Now the difference of all from 5.2 that we have to calculate over here. Okay, so so for this purpose I require this data to be in array format, because direct for a list it is not possible to perform subtraction. For array we can do the subtraction. Okay, if I do like this, 5.2, so I got an array, right, for every individual element. So I can create another list also, or if I want to perform some operation, if I directly do the subtraction of all of these elements, I can use a for loop to find the difference of all of these elements. But if I write like this, x minus m, okay, see this, it's possible only for the array. That's why I have converted the data structure into array format. For list it will not work. Now you can see the difference, standard difference among all from 4, it is okay. If you, how it is done actually, 4 minus 5.2, it is minus 1.2, correct? Okay, then 8 minus 5.2, this is 2.8. Okay, something like that it is calculated, and all of these values that we got over here. Now I want this value to be in absolute format. So how it is done, let's say nb.abs. So all these values are now in the positive number, that is in absolute format. These values are now printed on the screen. Let's see, np.abs, absolute. Okay, and now I want to calculate the average difference of all. So we'll be using the mean function for this. So let's see, np.mean. It is 2.04 for the data set which is mentioned here. Okay, or even we can put this also here. It's not, but instead of m, you can write it here. Yes, see, done. This is what we call as the mean absolute difference. Okay, the deviation, sir. Np dot mean of absolute values are difference from x minus the mean of all. This is the way that we can use. 2.04 is the mean. And the last one is called as the range. Range is the difference between minimum and maximum element, minimum and maximum. So if you just check mean of x, sorry, max of x minus mean of x, so we'll get this one. 7 is the range. So remember, there's a range function in Python. It's not similar to it. Ranges is to generate the set of element basically, but it's not the case over here. Directly you can subtract the maximum number and minimum number. So the difference between both is called as the range. Okay, we have seen the mid-range also. So mid-range is the center element. It's a average of minimum and maximum. It's called as mid-range, and range is called as the difference between minimum and maximum, is this one. Fine. So by that we can identify the spread of the data also. See how much elements are there, which minimum maximum numbers are present. What's the difference that they carry? So difference is 7 here. It means that the set of elements are not much bigger. They are not much bigger. Fine. So these are the ways by which the dispersion of the data can be seen, the spread of the data can be seen. Now we can summarize all them together. Even one more method is there by which dispersion can be seen, but it's there in the next unit, that is point the quartile method. So it's extension to the median, which we can extension to the median are there, but that we will see later words in the next session. It's a measure of different ideas. Okay, measure of different ideas are there, that's why it's not present over here. Okay, so this is how we can do this. What are the different methods that we can choose to perform operations on it? Even some functions are not present, like the mean absolute deviation. If you just check it out, mean absolute deviation. So it's not present actually. Default function is not there. Default function is not present. Median, mean are there, but for that deviation, because these ideas are not basically used very commonly. One thing is that when we are using the regression kind of algorithms, that time we have to find the difference between predicted values and actual values in the mean format. Okay, that there this formula of mean absolute deviation is used. But that's not actual deviation, it's mean absolute error. The difference between actual value and predicted values and their average we can find. So what is the average error we have? That we are calculating by this particular formula that we have seen here in mean absolute deviation. Okay, fine. So these methods are present here. Now if I want to summarize all of them together, the data set which I have used above just in the previous topic, it was df. So I'll use one function, it's called a describe. Now you can summarize all of them, not all, many of them here. See, describe. So this function will describe, means provide a summary of many of the function, not all, many of the functions. So you can see count, mean, standard deviation is this, minimum value. This is quartile value that we'll see in the next session. This is median value actually. Second quartile is median value. 50% return is a median. Middlemost element, remember. 75 third quartile and maximum values. Okay. So using that also we can calculate different sort of values present there. Like variance is not written here. So what's the variance present? So if you have to calculate the variance, you have to square the deviation. For example, df of age, okay, into 2, if you write like this. Square. So this is a deviation. Getting? Sorry, not this. So we have to write std. This is the deviation of it. So it was taken for all. I just summarize all. So standard deviation raised to 2 will become the variance of the data. And the mean absolute variance, if you want to calculate, so you can use this method. Like for example, if you want to apply it to the age columns, I can use this formula as it is. Okay, so instead of that x, I need to put the df of age. See, so again, mean absolute difference can be calculated by this method. It is a series format. Let's see if it's working. Instead of this x, I am putting it there. Yeah, 8.5. See, mean absolute deviation. Fine. So these are the methods which are used to find the spread of the data. Okay, one more thing to note, that outliers detection is possible by the mean and the median. There you can see mean, median, which are the center tendency methods here. As I told in last session also, if mean and the deviations, median are same, then the data is not containing much different spread over, variability is not much. Outliers are not there. Okay, so see 37 and 37 almost. Here it is 69,742, here it is 70,000. Outliers are not there. 0.35 and it is 0. Actually, two values are there. It's the output variable purchased. That's why it's a categorical variable. That's why we are getting this difference. Their minimum value is 0 and maximum is 1. And remaining others values are, no values are present in between that. But deviations and mean are calculated by it. So mean is 35. It means that maximum values are 0. Remember, if it is exactly 0.5, so both are equal, that we can find. Maximum values are 0. That's why this value is moving towards 0. Mean is moving towards 0. If it is moving towards 1, like 0.6, 0.8, so maximum value will be 1, that we can identify from this. These are the common ways by which we can identify, we can see the properties of the data within it. Fine. So these are the measures, and let's go with another topic to understand the testing methods which we can work, the third part of unit number 1. Wait a minute. Hypothesis. So what is hypothesis and what exactly the tests are present to test the hypothesis? That we will see. Few of them we'll see practically, and few of them only theoretically. Let's see hypothesis. Hypothesis, maybe if you heard about the idea multiple number of times, maybe if you have read somewhere, maybe if you are referring some books, there also hypothesis concept is used. So what exactly hypothesis is? Hypothesis is an educated guess about something in the world around you. Educated guess, you guess. So you, everyone is scientist, you are also scientist, so you guess it something, it's like that, or it is something like this. This is your guess, this is your theory. It was happening like that, you observed that it is happening like that, like this, you identify, yeah, there is some model present in that. If input is this, then output is like that. It's not, I'm talking about only mathematical input, but any general kind of situation, you see that very regularly, you see it, then you can identify, yeah, why it is happening like that, why it is happening like that, and you devise a theory behind it. Yeah, because of that, this is happening. This is your hypothesis. Remember, hypothesis. But remember, if you want to put that in the programming format, so it should be testable, it should get tested. We have to test it either by an experiment or observation. Okay, for example, a new medicine you think might work, you are a doctor, then only such guesses are there. You think that this may work. You have not yet implemented, you have just put a theory. That is called a hypothesis. The way of teaching you think might be better. So you think that this method is good, or this animation will be better for it. So student will greater understand it. They will go ahead with that. You think that practically talking about it will be better, create a better impact on students. Okay, yeah, this is what you can think. Or possible location of new species. Okay, so you are an explorer. So you are a biologist. And you think that at this particular location, which was unexplored, might that species will be found at that particular point of time. This is your observation. Okay, because this is the location, and because of many more reasons, because of the atmosphere available there, because of the locations, or because of many other reasons. Okay, it's present there, you can find it. Or the failure to administer standardized test. Many methods are there. You think that it will work. That is what we call as the hypothesis, a theoretical concept that you put. Hypothesis, it can be really anything at all, as long as you can put it in the test, you can see anything. But the problem is that we have to test it. We have to prove that is it the hypothesis, and whatever I put, that is 100% correct. And you have to create a model of it, statistical model of it. That is what we call as hypothesis and hypothesis testing. But before that, we need to know what exactly the meaning of hypothesis statement is. What is hypothesis statement? Now, if you are going to propose an hypothesis, it's customary to write a statement. Statement will look like this. It's a standard way to measure it. Remember that when you go through the research papers in machine learning, or not only that, in many different areas, they are putting something like that. If I do this to independent variable, then this will happen to the dependent variable. If this, then that. So you are finding the connectivity of input variable, output variable. There is some sort of connectivity. If I made this change, accordingly I will get that change in the output. This is how hypothesis statements are actually put. This is the idea which is present there. For example, some examples are mentioned here. If I decrease the amount of water given to herbs, then the herbs will increase in size. Yes. I want to grow that kind of herbs, and how much amount of water that I need to provide to them, that I'm expecting here. I'm to decrease it. So whatever amount of water I'm providing, I'm decreasing. So obviously that will increase it. This is your observation, or this we can put in the theory format. Or if I give patient counseling in addition to medication, then the overall depression scale will decrease. Yes. Only medication is not sufficient. So I can provide a counseling. So it can impact the patient's health, or the overall depression level that the patient is having can be decreased. That's what the patient, or that's what the hypothesis put by a doctor. Or if I give exam at noon instead of 7, then student test score will improve. 7. AM. Okay, instead of 7 AM, we are giving the test at 12. So possibilities that the score can be improved. Why? Because just before the examination, we are getting more time for revision or more time for studying. Maybe student test score can be improved. Hypothesis. Or if I look in this certain location, then I am more likely to find a new species. Yes, because again, many reasons. That's because the secondary part. But hypothesis statement is something like this way. But remember, to prove a hypothesis, we need to collect the data. That is what we call as features. Okay. And using that features, we have to prove the hypothesis statement by many different kind of methods. But before actually providing the hypothesis statement, you should have something base for that. Okay, what good hypothesis actually containing? This is what given by California University, I think. So what good hypothesis should contain? It's given there. Include an if and then statement. That's according to University of California, what should be the good hypothesis statement present? Okay, what's the goodness of hypothesis? They should contain if and then statement present in it. Okay. Then they should include both independent and dependent variables also. Independent variable is the input variable. Dependent variable is the output variable. If this, then it will happen to that in the output variables there. See, if you last time also we have seen many machine learning algorithms. Everywhere the concept is like there's a connectivity present input between input and output. Fine. That connectivity should be present. And when a good hypothesis is created, that algorithm, it will give good accuracy also. Okay. And third, that is, it should be testable by experiment, survey, or other scientifically sound technique. Testable by experiment, survey, or other scientifically sound technique. So many scientific techniques are there, but it should be testable. It should be in numerical format available, and we can use some standard methods to prove it. It should be based on information in prior research, either yours or someone else. He has told that this is there. Using this idea, I am using it ahead. Okay. So Isaac Newton has told that the universal constant of gravitation is 9.8 meter per second square. So I am using this, and accordingly that this is happening. This is my criteria for identifying the black hole in the universe. Like that you have put. Okay. I can use it. How much long jump we can be there on the moon? How can I identify? Because of prior research done using that, you can identify what's the gravitational force of moon, what's the gravitational force of earth, and accordingly proceed, find it. Like prior research that we have done. And it should have a design criteria for engineering or programming projects. Design criteria. So when I have to prove it, so should design criteria should be then how do you design it, where to get the data, how do you import the data, how to prove that particular hypothesis. That's like a programming language or a tool. Many tools, statistical tools are there. Like maybe if you heard about SPSS, is there, it used to perform that same operation. Vika is there. Tools are present. With help of tools also, you can put your hypothesis and you can prove it. So a good hypothesis is containing these particular properties present here. Now, what do you mean by the hypothesis testing? So this is what we need to learn, and the other topics are connected with the hypothesis testing here. Hypothesis testing is in statistics is a way for you to test the result of survey or experiment to see if you have meaningful results or not. If you have meaningful results or not. So whatever you have put in theory format, we have to prove that by putting the values inside it. We have to create an equation for the same. Check out that equation I mentioned. This is a generalized equation, it's not any concept present in, like z is equal to p hat minus p divided by square root of p q divided by n. Just an example, you can put it. So we require a good knowledge of mathematics, statistics in that case. So you're basically testing whether your results are valid by figuring out the odds that your results have happened by chance. Figuring out the odds that your results are happened by chance, maybe. It also possible that it was just a coincidence that it was happened. Correct. Was it the coincidence? If it is a coincidence, then hypothesis test will show you that it's a coin. It was the coincidence, and because of that, it was happened. Your observations are wrong. Observations are correct, but it was coincidental. That can also be proved with the help of a test, which is called as hypothesis test. So if your results may have happened by chance, the experiment won't be repeatable. so it has little use, it is not repeatable. So by chance, just like coincidence are there, that time this thing may happen. Fine. That's why it's required to know the hypothesis testing, the standard methods to test the hypothesis. Remember, the standard method to test the hypothesis, that should be known. So what is hypothesis testing? So it can be one of the most confusing aspect for students, mostly because before you can even perform a test, you have to know what your null hypothesis is. Null hypothesis, your previous assumption should be perfect. Null hypothesis means previous assumption, which is already proved. Often, those tricky word problems that you're faced, which can be difficult to decipher, but it's easier than you think, all you need to do is four parts are there, which we need to use in the hypothesis testing, which are mentioned over here. Check it. Figure out your null hypothesis. What is your null hypothesis? We'll talk about that. Then state your null hypothesis. Then choose what kind of test you can you need to perform on. What kind of test you can perform so your hypothesis can be tested. And then the last one, either support or reject the null hypothesis. Either support the hypothesis or reject the null hypothesis. Fine. So these four steps are there that we need to do while hypothesis testing. But one concept which is coming again and again here is called as, what is null hypothesis? See, basically previously when scientists were developing this hypothesis, or the standard techniques were used to prove it. Nowadays, if you want to prove something, you have to specify in the mathematical model format. Yeah, this is what I have observed and this is what I can prove. Yes, you have to prove it. Everywhere the proofs are required. So even scientific experiments are also not exception to that. You just put in the theory and you think that, yeah, this might work. Many such kind of theories are there which are not yet proved, but scientists has got fame because of it. So proving is very important and the core aspects of anything. See, so let's go. If you trace back the history of science, the null hypothesis is always the accepted fact. Hypothesis, null hypothesis is the accepted fact. Fine. Already it is accepted. Simply example of null hypothesis, we can generally accept it being true. Like DNA is like double helix. Already proved. And researchers have got the Nobel Prize for it. It's already proved. And using this concept ahead, you put your theory. So, which is already proved, which is called as the null hypothesis. There are 8 planets in the solar system. It were 9, but because of some scientific reasons, the Pluto has excluded from the same. 8 planets is already proved. Using this concept ahead, you are going to find 9th planet. So, putting the theory behind 9th planet, you have to assume that null hypothesis, at least 8 planets are there in the solar system. Okay. Or taking any kind of medicine can risk your heart problems. A drug can now taken off the market, which is not there. They already proved that it is having a risk of heart problems here. Okay, like all. So this is what we call as the null hypothesis. The hypothesis or the theory which is already proven, and using that theory ahead, we are going to make use of another statement of your own, and that is what you call a hypothesis, and null hypothesis is the base for it. Null hypothesis is the base. Using that, you are going ahead. Remember that no one is going to tell you you start from scratch. For example, I want to create a software, so I'm not starting from building a computer. Computer already built, correct? And no one is going to tell you create a compiler or interpret a programming language. It is already created, correct? Now what you can do by your own, that is what we are putting in hypothesis. Remember, in the research papers also, any kind of, not only data science or machine learning, any kind of research paper, they are also expecting the similar kind of things there. What was already proved, use that data, and what you can do on that, that we have to focus on. So null hypothesis is what, and what is your hypothesis? What is your theory? What is your theory? How can you prove it that you have to perform operations? This is what main method is there. Why it's there? Because when you are going to design a new machine learning data analytics operation algorithm, whatever you are suggesting, that should be provable, that should be testable. So it was like that previously. Its concept is this, and I am using this concept ahead. Like, see, just take an example of the decision tree algorithm. Decision tree algorithm is revised 3 number of times. Previously, it was named as ID3, iterative digit optimizer. There are some problems present in that. It has already been used. But using that concept ahead, I've created another decent algorithm whose number name is C4.5. Again, some problems were there. Problems are always there in every algorithm, but we are trying to use some standard statistical method to recover from it. So they have used that data ahead, and then another algorithm of C5.0 is created. And now we are using C5.0 algorithm. So using the base null hypothesis, you create another step, then next step, then next step. No, we are not going to start the thing from scratch. That's what the concept of hypothesis is. So whenever you have to design your own ML algorithm, we need to understand the standard method to put the hypothesis, standard method to know null hypothesis, standard method to prove your hypothesis also. So let's check. Yes, how to state the null hypothesis now? Now, you won't be required to actually perform a real experiment or survey in elementary statistics, or even you have to disprove fact like the Pluto is a planet. So we'll be given a word problem for real life situations. Yes, real life situations. So in this particular area, how input and outputs are expected and how accordingly their input is changing the output, that connectivity is that we can have. So you'll need to figure out what your hypothesis is from the problem. This can be a little trickier than just figuring out what the accepted fact is. So with word problems, you're looking to find a fact that is nullifiable. That's something that you can reject. Nullifiable means it is possible, it's having a possibility to get rejected. And acceptable, obviously, they are not going to get rejected from the same. Yes. Let's take a simple example here. How mathematically a hypothesis can be stated. So let's take an example of hypothesis testing here. See, a researcher thinks that if knee surgery patients go to physical therapy twice a week instead of three times, their recovery period will be longer. An average recovery times knee surgery patient is 8.2 weeks. This is your observation and hypothesis. Okay. A researcher thinks that if knee surgery patients go to physical therapy twice a week instead of three times, their recovery period will be longer. Average recovery time for knee surgery patient is 8.2. Now, using this idea, how the hypothesis and null hypothesis can be tested, stated. Hypothesis statement in this question is that the researcher believes the average recovery time is more than 8.2 weeks. Okay, it can be written mathematically like H1, that is your hypothesis statement is equal to mu is the recovery time is greater than 8.2. Average recovery time is 8.2 always. Okay, next you will need to find a null hypothesis for this. So we have already seen how to state null hypothesis. That is, what will happen if the researcher is wrong? The researcher is wrong. In this example, if the researcher is wrong, then recovery time is less than or equal to 8.2 weeks. Okay, that is your null hypothesis. H0, where mu is less than or equal to 8.2. Okay, if this is wrong, so obviously the null hypothesis will be having with us. So this is a common idea that we can put. Basically, we are having a large mathematical equations there, but the example which I shown, it doesn't contain any kind of long mathematical equation. It doesn't require that equation basically present over here. Now, to make the things practically, so in business, you're most likely constantly running experiments trying to improve something. Obviously, it's a human habit actually. It's a human tendency to get improved. Only human being, remaining others are not, means other animals are not actually being focused on that. But we are trying to improve it. What was previously done? Can I improve it? Next, can I improve? Improve. We are going to have multiple improvement present over. For instance, implementing a new process, running marketing campaigns, taking a poll, conducting surveys, as well as many others, like all. Many different ideas are there. Taking a poll also, we have seen from last 50 years, we have seen the voting ideas are changed different things are there. Survey conductions that were done differently, and now we are using different methods there. Okay, now we have implemented a change and capturing data from which you analyze the data before and after. What methods are actually used to access the data before, and now which methods are used nowadays? Okay, that we need to remember. So how can you tell the difference is not just because of a chance. So here we have the important statistical significance. By chance, we have observed, okay, but how can you prove it is not observed by chance? So making it practically, we have to use some test by which hypothesis can be tested, and we can prove that whatever theory I put, it's 100% correct. The theory I put is 100% correct. So to make it practically, we have to use some methods by which you can perform the operation of testing this hypothesis, is called as hypothesis testing. Okay, so before proceeding further, we'll take a break of 2-3 minutes, and after that we will continue the remaining topic. We'll see the things practically also. Thank you.